Father, we thank you for your grace, your goodness, your blessings, and all that you have done for us. We thank you for the provisions you made for us over 2,000 years ago. Lord, you came down, and from heaven, you emptied yourself with all of those of your power, your glory, and came down in the likeness of sinful flesh. Lord, we thank you for the sacrifice you made, the price you paid, the victory, the battle you fought, and the victory that you won. It's because of that victory over sin, Satan, death, and hell, and the grave. Lord, we have remission of our sins, oh God. We have salvation by faith through the grace of God. Father, we thank you that the grace of God has appeared unto all men, teaching us, denying ungodliness and worldly lust, that we can live righteously, soberly, and godly. We can live it. Lord, you give not only saving grace, but you give standing grace. Yes, standing grace, Lord. Hallelujah. We can stand victorious. We can reign in this life over sin, over Satan, over our circumstances, and over all of the power of the enemy. We can reign because you have given us abundance of grace. Yes, and grace is that ability that only you can give. Yes, hallelujah. We thank you today, Lord, for the victory. Yes, this is the victory that overcomes. The victory, the victory. Yes, hallelujah. Being born of you, receiving eternal life. Having the dimension of death. Yes, broken over our lives. That is the victory. That is the victory. Hey, Jesus coming in and making his abode. Hallelujah, within our hearts. Lord, this is the victory that overcomes the world. Because with you in us, and with you for us, and with your Holy Spirit leading and guiding and controlling and running our lives, Lord, we can overcome by the blood and the word of our testimony. Father, we give you the praise. We give you the glory. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Oh, it's a precious name. Oh, it's a marvelous name. Oh, God. All that Jesus died for, hallelujah, paid for, suffered for, yes, defeated Satan for, yes, and rose again for, everything is in that wonderful name. Oh, that name has been highly exalted. Oh, in the name of Jesus. We have the victory in the name of Jesus. Satan will have to flee. Oh, God, we thank you for the dominion, the riches in that name, the honor in the name, the powers in the name, the blessings are in the name. And all that we need, salvation is in no other. Hey, salvation is in no other. No other name given unto men whereby we might be delivered. Save in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you tonight because we rejoice. Yes, in the name. You said, fear not, O ye lands. Rejoice and be glad, and you will do great things. Lord, it's a blessing in the light in you. Yeah, you said you would give us. Hey! The desires of our heart. Oh, whatever we desire. Whatever we ask in the name of Jesus. Whatsoever thing you desire when you pray. Yes, Lord, all of these things are included as we delight in you. That's the reason why, Father, when we come to the house of the Lord, oh, we want to bless you. We want to do a good job of it. Yes, we want to put ourselves in it. We want to put our hearts in it. We want to release our spirits. Oh, God, because you said that if we bless you with all that's within us, Lord, you will begin to respond. You will begin to forgive all of our iniquities. You'll heal all of our diseases. You will crown us with love and kindness and tender mercies. You will satisfy. Lord, all that we need, hey, is in you. Hey, your grace is sufficient tonight. Yes, it's sufficient tonight. It's sufficient. It's able to keep us from falling. able to present us faultless before your presence, able to meet every need according to your riches and glory through Christ Jesus. Father, we give you the praise and the glory. Yes, we honor you. Lord, we have our limitations and our ability to pray in our own language. We go beyond the barriers that hinder us. Hey, Lord, we pray in the Holy Ghost. Every opportunity. Every time we come to worship, Lord, just a few minutes. Yeah, Lord, going beyond the boundaries, going beyond the barriers, going beyond the limitations, going beyond our flesh, going beyond our feelings, and begin to kalia and praise you, Lord, in the beauty of holiness. Gando Mosha. Seshini. Lord, Worskeskaramaha. Workosko Mankarabaha. Doriarabahata. Korabahatanda. Oh, just let it be skaskaramarisha. Let it be hila lamaho. Let it be hila lamaho koshanta. Lord, let it be. According to your word, according to your word, in Jesus' name, we thank you, Lord, that you are working now, working within us, your will and the ability to carry out all that you have called us to do. We give you the praise and the glory now, in Jesus' name. Everybody just say, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Everybody say, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. Glory. All right, we just want to admonish you to keep working in your workbooks. You should be through with lesson two. We didn't assign lesson one, but a smart, industrious student would go back and do all of the things you don't ask them to do. Those that just want to do just enough to get by, they just do it. Exactly what you tell them, and that's all. Amen. So I just wanted to mention that the soul winner's manual. Yes. Okay. Do I have another book like that? Okay. I don't have one with me, but I can get you one. I'll be glad to get you one.
Oh.
All right. Okay. We want to become a lot more balanced. In our approach, in other words, we want to be able to pray for others. Like we did Sunday, I really appreciate the service Sunday when everybody began to pray. And I think that your ability to pray and to help others to get their release on Sundays, or whatever you call them, depends on what you do on a daily basis. Amen. How many can say amen?
Amen.
So we're not saved just to come. And just to come to church and go back, come to church and what? Go back. We want to be able to be a blessing to those that are coming. So we want you to be fired up. Everybody just say, we need to get fired up.
Amen.
So Sunday we can really begin to pray. Now we have a brother Butler. And his wife was here Sunday, and it was a real blessing to have him. Amen. And he has expressed to me his hunger and his desire for more of the Lord. I think that all of us ought to be concerned about our fellow sisters and brothers. Amen. How we can pray them through, how we can lead them to the Holy Spirit baptism within that field. I believe that this is a responsibility that all of us have as believers. And I'm very, very serious. Take somebody and just say, Pastor, serious.
That's serious.
Amen. I just want you to understand that it's kind of important for you to be able to minister the Holy Spirit to people, salvation and the Holy Spirit to people on a one-on-one. Amen. Amen. You know amens? People say, well, they're supposed to get saved and feel the Holy Ghost at the altar.
No.
All right. And some say, well, a pastor's supposed to do all of that.
No.
But the ministry that all of us have been given is a soul winning ministry. Everybody say a soul winning ministry. Holy Ghost filled ministry. And a healing ministry. And a ministry that will help people to what? To grow and develop. All of us have that responsibility. So this brother here, I'm going to give him this soul winner's manual, and we want to see him filled with the Holy Ghost as quickly as he possibly can.
Amen.
All right, so that's all of the instructions for salvation, all of the instructions for receiving the baptism of the Holy Spirit is in that book. All right, so we just want you to remember that that's very, very important for you to be able to lead people to the Holy Spirit baptism. I know sometimes people say, well, that's not me. That's not my personality. I don't like to confront people. I don't like to deal with them in that way. But that's the three things that God is interested in. In this chapter, we saw that God is interested in people being what? Saved. And he's interested in people being what? Filled with the Holy Spirit. And he's interested in people growing up what? Spiritually. Those are the things that God is very, very interested in. And for that reason, the judgment that would be rendered at the judgment seat will be focused around the thing, did we do the things that God is interested in? Did we focus on the primary things that God told us to do? That's going to be the focus of the judgment seat of Christ. Amen. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
All right, so chapter 2, we pretty well have covered that, questions and all of that. I want you to begin to work through lesson 3, lesson 4. Lesson 4 is the lesson that we want to master, and because that is a very, very important lesson. Okay, I want to just give you a few things that would be a blessing to you. You can just write these down as much as you can. The things are works which we will specifically be judged on. The things are works which we will specifically be judged. So this is where the rubber meets the road. God wants us to be concerned about the things that he sent Jesus to do and to follow his example. And by following the example of Jesus, we automatically will fulfill God's plan, amen, for our lives. All right, the number one thing I have on my list here, amen, this is at the judgment seat, and we mentioned that the judgment seat will take place just after Jesus comes to the earth, come down. He's not coming to the earth, but he's coming in the air to receive the church of the bride unto himself. And they will be called up to meet him, and the thing that will transpire after we are called up to heaven, according to Revelation 4, we will be judged. We will be judged. Amen. Luke 14:14. It says this, and thou shalt be blessed, for they cannot recompense thee. This was speaking about verse 13, but when thou makest a feast, call the poor, the maimed, the lame, the blind. Okay, if I want to, maybe I should go up another one. Verse 20. Then said he also to him that bade him, when thou makest a dinner or supper, call not thy friends, nor thy brethren, neither thy kinsmen, nor thy rich neighbors, lest they bid thee again, and a recompense be made thee. But when thou makest a feast, call the poor, the maimed, the lame, the blind, and thou shalt be blessed. You're going to be rewarded Whatever you do, whatever you give to even a prophet in the name of a prophet, or a righteous man in the name of a righteous man, or even to the poor, the scripture says we're going to be rewarded for all of our good and noble deeds that we render to mankind. And thou shalt be blessed, for they cannot recompense thee, for thou shalt be recompensed at the resurrection of the just. All right, so the resurrection of the just is the time that we will receive our rewards. So when we attend funerals, many times we say that she's going on to receive her reward. But the reward won't take place until we are resurrected, until the resurrection of the just takes place. That's when the reward, the judgment, will be needed, and we will be judged, and then the rewards will be what? Given out, crowns, and all of the special recognitions, and all that God has for us, that will be released after the resurrection of the just takes place. Okay, let's look over at Revelation 4. You can see, again, that it takes place. Okay, Revelation 4. After this, let's read the first verse. After this, I looked, and behold, a door was open in heaven, and the first voice which I heard was as it were of a trumpet talking with me, which said, come up hither, and I will show thee things which must be hereafter. Okay, this is the call of the Lord for the church to come up hither. This is what we call the coming of the Lord in the air. This will be the first resurrection, when we're going to be caught up to meet the Lord. Amen. And let me just say, so all of this describes the scene in heaven. And immediately I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne was set in heaven, and one sat on the throne. He that sat was to look upon like a jasper. This is Jesus. And a sardine stone, and there was a rainbow round about the throne, in sight like unto an emerald. And round about the throne were 24 seats. And upon the seats I saw 24 elders sitting clothed in white raiment, and they had on their heads crowns of gold. And out of the throne proceeded lightnings and thunderings and voices, and there were 7 lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the 7 spirits of God. And before the throne there was a sea of glass like unto crystal, and in the midst of the throne and around about the throne were 4 beasts full of eyes before and behind. And the first beast was like a lion, the second beast like a calf, the third beast had a face as a man, and the fourth beast was like a flying eagle. The 4 beasts had each of them 6 wings about him, and they were full of eyes within, and they rest not day and night, saying, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, which was and is to come. And when those beasts give glory and honor and thanks to him that sat on the throne, who liveth forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him that sat on the throne and worship him and liveth forever and ever, and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. So verse 10 is the scripture that shows that the crowns and the various commendations and the everything that God is going to bestow upon us will be done at the judgment seat of Christ. And it says here, and those crowns, see, there will be crown of life. I'm going to talk about the crown of rejoicing, crown of righteousness, incorruptible crown. And then there is a crown of glory, which is reserved for pastors and leaders. So those crowns that were issued, that were given to those that were faithful, those crowns are going to be cast down, amen, before the throne. Amen. So that's the purpose of the crowns. They're going to be what? Not something you can gloat about. People say, well, look how shiny my crown is. Look how many I got. Look how I got 200 stars in my crown. It's not, the crowns are not going to be issued for some, for you to be going around in heaven to boast about how, you know, how many you got and how bright your crowns are shining. But they're going to be reserved to what? Throw down at the feet of Jesus. Amen. All of the crowns are going to be what? Cast down before the throne. Amen. Worthy to receive. How many know it's going to be a lot better to cast crowns down, amen, than to cast ashes?
Amen.
Ashes. Amen. Ashes would be works that weren't worthy of what? Crown. Or rewarding. So it's going to be a glorious time when the saints can cast their crowns before the throne and begin to praise the Lord. Thou art worthy. Hey, but y'all might as well get used to it now. Thou art worthy. Someone was acting like we scared to say it now. Thou art worthy. Shara Bahosha. Lava Kara Bahosha. Thou art worthy to receive what? Glory and honor and power. For thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. Number one, crown of life. All right, crown of life is for faithfulness in using your time, abilities, and resources. Faithfulness in using your time, abilities, and resources. That's going to be crown. That's going to be an issue that God will raise at the judgment seat. How you use your time, how you use your abilities, and how you use your resources. I have a scripture here, Colossians 4:6. It says, I'd like you to turn there, Colossians 4:6. It says, redeeming the time because of the things are evil. Colossians 4, redeeming the time. Somebody have to look at that. Redeeming the time because. Okay. Verse 5. Walk in wisdom toward them that are without, redeeming the time. Redeeming the time. Big part? Yeah, 4, verse 5. Okay, redeeming the time. So that means that we don't have any time to do what? To loaf around and to be idle. Remember something we mentioned about the abundance of idleness? And we really began to watch our time, how we spend our time, because God is going to hold us accountable for the time that he has given us. This also look at Ephesians 5:14. It says, wherefore, this is Ephesians 5:14. Wherefore, he said, awake thou that sleepest, and arise from the dead, and Christ shall give thee light. See then that ye walk circumspectly, not as fools, but as what? Wise, redeeming the time, because the days are what? Evil. Wherefore, be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is. All right? Be not drunk. This is also dealing with your time. Be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. But be filled. Amen. Everybody said be filled.
Be filled.
Speaking to yourselves in what? Psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Giving thanks always for all things unto God and the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Those are some spiritual disciplines that we really need to know, because these things are, I would say, really important that we're going to redeem the time. We really have to make the most out of the time that we have. And the scripture says that by being filled with the Spirit, that will enable us to what? To redeem the time. That will enable us to make the most out of the time that we have been given. So this kind of rules out. Sister Hill, come on and take your place. I can't get quite right up to the new time. Redeeming the time because the days are evil. Now this should challenge us in the area of being filled with the Spirit. Being filled with the Spirit. How many believe that there is a lot of room for improvement in terms of us being able to be what filled with the Spirit? Because what you're going to be able to accomplish depends a whole lot on what? The extent that you let go and let what? God have his way.
Amen.
Is that right?
Yeah.
And he wants us to be filled. And how do you be filled with the Spirit? There are some things that, there are some lessons that we can learn here. It says that speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Speaking to yourselves. And I think that we can speak to ourselves personally in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. This is something that we need to take advantage of in order for us to really begin to redeem the time and really place ourselves in the position where we are filled with all the Spirit. I just want you to just dwell on that a minute. This is something that I've been focusing on quite a bit. Speaking to yourselves in hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. I've been focusing and trying to admonish you to begin to speak in terms of songs and hymns and spiritual songs. Amen. Spiritual songs are things you can make up in the Spirit. So you're not to be limited by just what you already know of the way that you always pray and the tradition that we've always followed. And this is something that I feel that we need to what, get beyond and begin to sing songs. Everybody says sing songs. All right, everybody says sing song. I don't know what a song is. What is a song? A song is what? Amen. In other words, just, you know, let's begin to sing the scripture. Is that okay? Sing the song. Sing the scripture. Amen. Speak it, and you can always what? You can always sing it. I know that whenever I get on this topic, it just seems like everything just goes flat. Because, you know, it's kind of difficult to reason with people that we need to be singing the scriptures, singing psalms, making up spiritual songs. And during our prayer time, we ought to be kind of intermingling all of these forms of prayers, because the scripture did say, pray with all prayers. In order to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, it's a real task just dealing with the cares of life now. The things that we have to deal with, the things that we have to go through, all of the cares of life, the temptations, the challenges, the conflicts, and how in the world can we contend with all of this without being filled with the Holy Spirit? And in order to be filled with the Holy Spirit, there is some disciplines that we really have to do. I mean, we really need to watch what the Bible said. The Bible is telling us, speak to yourself. We might tell somebody next to you, speak to yourself. Now, I think that that could be twofold. We can speak to yourself. You can speak personally. Amen. I speak to myself all the time through Scripture. I just say it as much as I can. But recently, I know that I never could be a professional singer in the world. And I just began to figure out that how I can, amen, get pretty good in the Spirit. And I really enjoy just singing the Word, singing whatever God lays on my heart. Put it in a song and begin to what? Rejoice. Amen. So this is what God wants us to do. He wants us to really begin to what? Sing the Word. Pray the Word. Amen. And I like it better singing than just saying. Amen. How many like to sing? How many wish you could sing? All right. Well, John Pastor. Amen. All of us can sing, and all of it will be what? Pleasing to God. All God is asking for us to do is what? Speak to yourselves and what? Psalms and hymns. He didn't say it had to be a certain quality. He didn't say you had to be professional, right? Right? He says, speak to yourselves in what? Psalms and hymns and spirituals. Speak to one another. Speak to one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Speak to one another. Speak to one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. Amen. So if I would just let everybody just stop right here. And say, let everybody let's stop and let's speak in psalms. Amen. How quiet would it be, sister?
How quiet
would it be?
I can speak, but I can't sing it now.
All right, see. Okay, in order to be able to sing, because it is a real, you know, the Bible speaks about, in terms of the form of praises, the Bible speaks more about singing than anything else.
Yes, yes.
Because singing is the best way to get the word deep down in you and to really get yourself, what, filled with the Holy Spirit. Singing. Amen. All right, so that is something that we want to begin to major on, is because we want to redeem the time because the days are evil. And I want you to begin, everybody just begin to practice singing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Now, this book here, the Lord's Compassion Manual, this is a good book here because it has all of the scriptures kind of in our group. Remember all of those scriptures we used when we talked about the Lord's compassion? You know, that God's eyes are running to and fro throughout the whole earth. You know, all of those scriptures are in here. And this is the best 20-some page book you will ever have. I mean, this can build you up big time. I've gone through all of these scriptures. I've gone through all of these scriptures and made songs out of them.
Oh, okay.
I mean, I don't have a song. I didn't have my, I didn't write them. I mean, I just, I hear
you. But you can sing them, right?
Right, I just sing them. I make every scripture that I turn to, I make it rhyme or come out in a song or tune or something. And every time I sing it, boy, I just get really happy. Hey, you still up? All right. So I have them all in here, and I'm not trying to sell it, but I'm just trying to let you know that all of this is at $10. This is all at your disposal. All of the teaching that I did on the Lord's compassion is in here. Okay. So let's move on. Redeeming the time, because what? The days are what? Evil. So that means that we need to really begin to sing in the spirit, because I don't know how in the world we can keep up with all of the things coming against us if we don't do this. I just don't see it. I just don't see how we can contend with everything that we are to contend with and not really do what the word says do, in order to what? To build yourself up to a point where these things will not be able to what? Amen. To override your walk with the Lord. Amen. So that is an assignment. We need to work on some personal things rather than watching TV and all of these things that we do, wasting time. We need to be what? Perfecting our own spirits, building up our spirits. Amen. By what? Speaking psalms and hymns and what? Spiritual songs. Amen.
Amen.
All right. And I guarantee you, I don't care how long that scripture is, I make it rhyme or come out right. And amen. And every time I sing it two or three times, I just feel something jumping up in my spirit. I said, man, I ain't never felt that before. Woo. So that singing really does a job on the inside. Now, if y'all just want to stick with what? Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. So I'd like to even go beyond just praying in the spirit, just the way that we've done it for the last 20-some years. I like to go beyond that. Most times I never know what I'm gonna, how I'm going to pray when I come. I try to keep from praying the way that I always prayed in the past. Right. Yeah, David danced with all of his might. He danced until he lost his what? His clothes. Right?
Yeah,
is that right?
Yeah, voice. I don't think I can sing. It wasn't bad. My voice.
Yeah, he's Raymond, yes. Okay, he's Royal Raymond. Well, anyway, that was, he was unclothed, undressed, he wasn't, you know, fully. Okay, but that's a good question. Okay, Sister Banks, I'm glad you brought that up. Turn to Colossians 3:23-24.
What was the question?
Okay, she was just making a remark about David dancing with all of his might. Okay, your question is, should we dance with all, is that your question? Should we dance with all of our might?
Yeah, and sing too.
Okay, and we stop dancing all together. We just stop dancing all together. Amen. For the most part. And that's going backwards. That's backsliding too. Okay, should we dance today? Is dancing outdated? Oh, something that we don't have to be concerned about today. Should we be concerned about dancing today?
If you're not dancing for the Lord, you better be concerned.
All right.
If you're not dancing the world dancing,
then
that's another thing.
All right, so Mike said, out in the world, that's another thing, but we need to be trying to dance for the Lord. All right, so who wants to lead out this coming week? Lead out and dance. Come on. I want to have somebody in place. Here's the Holy Ghost. All right. Oh, I tell you, if some of y'all start out dancing, boy, I'm telling you, praise God. I mean, this church will go up. All right, so we want to bring back, Sister Bikes mentioned that, we need to bring back our dance. That is a level of praise called what? What level of praise is dance? You dance with all of your might. All right, y'all can tell me that later. All right, Colossians 3:23-24. Now, faithfulness in the use of your time, abilities, and resources is going to be an issue that will be brought up at the judgment seat of Christ. What did you do with your time, your abilities, and your resources? And the scripture that we just read, that we need to what? Redeem our time. Speaking about the time, and he didn't mention abilities here. But redeeming your time because the days are what? Are evil. Okay? Now, the ability issue, let's see if we can find something there. Colossians 3:23-24. If you haven't, read it for me. Colossians 3:23-24.
And whatsoever you do, do it heartily as the Lord, and not unto men, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ.
Okay, those are two scriptures that shows how much importance the Lord places on your ability. Whatever you do, do it what? Heartedly.
Yes.
Heartedly. That means with what? With your whole heart. Do it all to the best of your ability. Make full use of the ability that God has given you. Make full use of it. Because some of us, some won't make it, because we'll be judged accordingly, but those that make full use of your ability, those are going to receive the commendation which says that, well done, thou good and what? Thou faithful servant, enter into the joy of the Lord. So you will have an abundant interest into the kingdom. You will have an abundant interest. All right? Knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Jesus. So there is going to be a reward of the inheritance that will be given to those that will do things heartily as to the Lord. Just as if the Lord was here being your what? Master that will be watching every move, everything that you do. Okay. So that also kind of reinforced the fact that whatever we're doing to the Lord, we need to be what? Doing it with all of our what? Heart.
Amen.
And how many know that we need to put a whole lot more in what we're doing?
Hallelujah. Yes.
Is that right?
Yes.
Amen. So, you know, being a preacher, being a pastor, being a teacher, you know, Brother Williams and all of us know the praise and praise. We know about what happens on Sunday mornings, what level of commitment we make in terms of worship. All right, somebody from the praise team talk. Let Brother Williams talk. What level of commitment are we talking about in terms of, are we doing it unto the Lord, or are we doing it to please ourselves? All right, so, well, I guess nobody wants to say anything.
I feel we're doing it to the Lord, we're just not all part of it, like you said.
All right, my sister.
Praise it, but I think it's me. I'm not talking about nobody else, but me.
Mm-hmm.
Should be more out there.
Right.
More.
All right, now, my next confession is good for you.
I'm just going to hear us.
Oh. I said I can speak for me. I'm praising the Lord, but not all heartedly. I know I could do more, but I can't sing.
Yeah. All right, she said.
But I be practicing that.
She can't
home.
Sing.
Nobody's there and can hear me but the house.
All right. Okay, so I think that's good that you said that I could put a lot more of me in. But sometimes, you know, the praise people be pulling and the musician be pulling and the preacher be pulling, and you know, sometimes you just be, you know,
I feel you, but
you just say, well, what's going on, why won't they just open their mouth a little wider and try to what, put more into it so more people could get what, blessed?
Yes. Amen.
Because when we hold back like that, that means that a lot of people that would be blessed won't get it. They're not going to get it because the atmosphere is what is not conducive for people to get that full release because we hold back. All right, so Sister Mike, you spoke, I appreciate that. Okay, anybody else? Okay, Brother Lee.
Yeah, I remember when I first got saved back a long time ago, coming out of the Baptist church and coming to a spiritual church, I remember the old saints, Sister Johnson, Brother mm-hmm. Johnson, Brother Larry, Sister Jackson, mm-hmm. all of that, you know, crowd back then, they were very vocal.
Yeah.
And it makes you, you know, look around and try to think, what, wow, you know. But that caused a lot of spiritual development in me, you know.
Really?
When I was inhibited about, because I was coming from a culture where it's quiet,
right,
to a culture where there's noise, mm-hmm. kind of get a little liberation.
Right.
Say, hey, it's okay.
All right, well, the preacher talking, you cares about waiting for the preacher talk. All right. Now, he mentioned that the older saints seemed like they were, they understood the importance of what, letting go and let God have his way. And they were a lot more uninhibited, is that right, than we are today. And those blessings that they initiated, those breakthroughs and lifting their voices, praying, and sometimes you hear them broken, weeping and crying, and praising God with all of their heart, God using them in the gifts and spirit and all of that. That really motivated a whole lot of us to what? To open up and what? Release our praises to the Lord in a greater what? Dimension. But what has happened to all of the old saints? I mean, those that used to carry that type of anointing, what has happened? Well, I know some of them are going on, right? Some of them are dead, but we not. We still here, right?
Yes.
And some of them are in ministry, you know, and God is really using them. But we just miss that because sometimes it goes, Sundays, a lot of Sundays go by, and sometimes you just don't feel that freshness, that wholehearted release in the spirit where people are really crying out to God and giving their whole heart to God in worship. Sometimes several weeks go by and sometimes that don't happen. And I was just wondering if you feel okay not experiencing that. If you feel all right, if you don't miss it. Well, some of us maybe weren't here in those days. But we've had times where just those of you that's here now, we've had some pretty, you know, eventful services where God really had his way. And I will tell you that Sunday before last was kind of one of those, right? And Sunday, after we ministered, we started praying for people. If we had taken another hour, a half an hour, it would have been a bigger breakthrough. But the pressure was on me to what? Let the people go. Let the people go. Let the people go. They're just sitting around looking, but they're tired. They're ready to go home. All right, let's go. Let's move on. Well, thank you, Brother Williams, for that. All right. You came tonight. Oh, Lord. She just talks flat straight from her heart. And I really appreciate that. Okay, now you kind of put me on the spot because maybe you need to start, I guess us preachers need to start what? Dancing.
You do.
I'm not a good dancer. I couldn't even dance in the world at all. But some of y'all are good dancers in the world, so you can really get some stuff stirred up around here if you got it loose. I tell you somebody that really blessed me when they get loose every time. Sister Deborah Lee. She's from the old school. So it's down in her, so let's just push her. Encourage her, y'all encourage her. But she got it from an old school. And we just need more of that, what released in our services, because we really need to draw from that. Okay, somebody trying to get my attention. Okay, Brother Butler.
You know, what Brother Williams was saying, my grandmother told me that it seems like the further we get from slavery and racial oppression, the less and less we seem to really have those kind of breakthroughs, or the less and less we seem to be broken. To more depend on ourselves instead of depending on God.
That's good.
And I thought that, you know, that really meant a lot to me as she was telling me that, because it seemed like, as he said, when I would go to church with her back in the day, you know, they were broken and they had a lot to really, you know, thank God for. And, where today it seems like we're more into ourselves.
What we refuse to do too. Okay, that's really, really, he's from the old school. His wife grew up in, I think, you know, Jackson's church. Those were the days we were fasting and praying and seeking God, and people were getting saved and filled with the Holy Spirit. But those are the days that we really, really, I long for. And I do the best I can sometimes to try to turn it back the other way. But sometimes people look at me and say, Oh, Pastor. You don't take all of that. Sometimes I just feel that. Maybe y'all don't be thinking, oh, Pastor, you don't take all of that. And don't bother me about praying in the Spirit. Don't bother me about trying to sing a melody in the Spirit. Don't bother me. Just let me just go on the way I've always done it. All right, well, the solution, I guess we probably need to address what we can do to get this reactivated, and I'm pretty sure all of us.
All of you.
Okay, brother.
That's got a lot to do with the attitude on Sunday. You know, even though we have 6 days and we're working and involved, mm-hmm. secular, but we don't see Sunday anymore as that day set aside by the Lord.
All right, we don't see that as a day set aside for the Lord. So we kind of box ourselves in because we try to get people in, get them out, so they can go back home and watch the games and cook and do all the other things that they want. So we don't really You know, I'm not saying that we need to hold church all day, but I do believe that sometimes we need to really focus on trying to get people at a level where they can really begin to get a release from a whole lot of things. And that doesn't come real quick. Most times it doesn't come real quick. You know, if you got three people trying to get it through, and then you have 25 or 30, so I'm ready to go. I'm tired. I'm not getting nothing out of this. This is boring. You know, then, you know, that's one of the challenges that we have. And that's the challenge that we have all over, not just here in Northside Christian Center.
Yeah.
But it just seems like something that really is needed today that we don't have is kind of eluding us. And I think in order to get it back in place, I think it's going to be a sacrifice. And I think the next two or three chapters, we're going to see that it took a sacrifice on the part of Moses in order for him to attain to the point where he became perhaps the most astounding figure. I guess he was the most commending figure of the Old Testament, the mediator of the law, and he was just an out. But it took a lot of what? Sacrifices. He had to really, what, give up and to yield to God and do a lot of things that was contrary, I'm sure, to his way of doing things. So that's very good. I don't want to spend the whole night on one thing, but that scripture is very timely. Whatever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that of the Lord you shall receive a reward of the inheritance. You're going to receive whatever you give out is going to what? Come back to you again. So God is waiting in judgment to bring all of these things to light. If you're half-hearted, you didn't give all, just messed around with what I gave you, you wouldn't use it to the fullest extent of your ability, and now here you are at the judgment seat and you want a full reward. And you didn't do no full-hearted what? Commitment. All right, now Luke 16, 10 and 12, this is about the resources, not faithful in the unrighteous mammon. So God wants us to be faithful without the money. This is another issue that is going to be brought up in judgment, because money, I would say money is the closest thing to most people's heart. Money is the closest thing to your heart. It's the sum total of all that God has done through. It's the sum total of all your sweat, your intelligence, your experience, your life's blood. Money represents that in a nutshell. So what you do with your money, how willing you are to go beyond whatever is normally required. Sometimes people just go right to the tithe and offer. They don't go a bit further. Some don't even go that far. And some say, well, I'm giving my tenth part, I ain't going to give another nickel. And I think that you have to really be flexible, because sometimes the Lord will require you to go what far beyond your tithe and your offerings. Amen. If you listen to the Spirit of God, sometimes you will be challenged to go what far beyond what you normally do. Amen. Now, if this church is in, the money doesn't come in, or somebody hold their tithing, and, you know, of course, these are things that we always, you know, encounter, then that means that somebody will have to, what, dig up, you know, maybe $400 or $500 of the young. You know, I wouldn't ask most of you to do that. Sometimes we try to get a general offering, but, you know, but there would be a time that $1,000 might have to be put into the church in order to keep things going while people are on vacation or people are holding the money. So things like that, you're going to get rewarded big time for things like that, going beyond the call of duty. And here's the thing, that most people wouldn't be willing to do that. I don't care how spiritual they are, they wouldn't be willing to to sacrifice $500 or $1,000 at a time, or $5,000 at a time, for the sake of the gospel. But they would make that commitment for a television, Well, how big the screen have to be $5,000? I don't know. But for a car or whatever they like, they will make that what? Commitment. So I'm going to tell you, it's a whole lot more in money being flexible in that area than most of us realize. It has a whole lot to do with your anointing, your gifts, how God will use you, how you see things, how effective you are with people. A lot of that hinges around, amen, the value that you place on your money. I mean, you'd be surprised. You'd be surprised of how important it is. Because I never, when we were going through a crisis, when the water line broke back here, gas line, you know, it was weeks and weeks and weeks we were trying to locate it. That was the time that the Lord challenged me to just be real free with whatever He blesses me with. And just don't consider going to a certain point. Well, I've done my duty, I paid my tithe, I've given my offerings, so I'm not going to give another damn. The Lord took from me the right to claim my money. And from that time on, my prayer took a different direction. That's the time I began to get my breakthrough in prayer. When I said, Lord, I don't care, if it takes it, you know, I don't like to shell out money I mean, just, you know, arbitrarily, I don't like to do it. But if the need is there and it doesn't come in any other way, you know, I'm willing to do it. And ever since then, my life has been totally different. I mean, my prayer and my the way I see things, my revelation, and how God is using me, and you know, a whole lot of other things. It's very important. Okay, Luke 16, verse 10 through 12. Luke 16, verses 10 through 12. 10 through 12. I guess I have the right scripture. It says this, 16. Yeah, that's the right one. It says, he that is faithful in that which is what? Least. Is faithful also in what?
Much.
And he that is what? Unjust in the least is what? Unjust also in what? Much. If therefore you have not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, who will commit to your trust the true riches? And if you have not been faithful in that which is another man's, who shall give you that which is your own? Okay, so that's a very powerful scripture. It mentions that if you're not faithful in with your natural resources, then how could God commit true riches to you, even in this life, or even in the life to come? How can God put you over things which are really important? In other words, true riches are things that deal with spiritual issues. So your faithfulness in terms of spiritual issues and your ability to be effective with people in the spirit realm hinges around your faithfulness in the area of your finances. If you're not faithful in that, then God can't anoint you or entrust you with the ability to help. You know, this brother here, Brother Butler, I mean, it's very rare you find a brother that has had the experience he has had in his past. Amen. And he just expressing his hunger for God the other night when I talked with him. But he's hungry for God, and he wants to be filled with the Holy Spirit. He wants to be flowing in the Holy Spirit. Now, anybody just can't lay hands on him or get with him and instruct him and lead him to that experience. And I believe a lot of times, because many times we are not able to do that, it's not always the money issue. You know, sometimes it's the issue of not yielding, as we said earlier, not yielding in praise and worship and letting the Lord use us, the brokenness. A lot of that is the issue as well. But How could God trust us with his soul when he can't trust you with the money thing? Does that make sense?
Yes.
No, does it make sense?
Yes.
Okay, now just tell me, suppose you had somebody working for you, you had an employee, amen, how much, if you couldn't trust, if you couldn't trust him to handle your money properly, you know, how much trust and confidence could you have in him using, I mean, being able to, what am I trying to say?
They couldn't handle their money, how would you trust him to handle yours?
Right, that's right. All right, you always get me out of a hole. I was there. All right, if they don't handle their money properly, amen, how, you wouldn't want to trust him to what? Okay, you wouldn't want to put somebody over your business that got a bad record of what, paying that what, debt? Right, they don't know what a budget is, and they don't, I mean, they got all kind of clouds hanging over their head. So what I'm saying is that we have to bring ourselves to the point where we are faithful with what? Your money. But that's the closest thing to your, if you're not faithful with that, you're going to be faithful with what? You're going to be doing stuff all the way down the line that's not going to what? Please God. Now, I'm not saying everybody that tithe and give offerings and that's, you know, that's really free in that area are following God all the way, but I believe that that is a good start. That's the first thing that God tells us to do after we get saved. He said, put me first. Just try me. Is that right? And he asked us to what? To give to him first. The first one, the tenth part, and then the offerings. And that's the ABCs of the Christian walk. If you don't get that, this is how God has ordained for us to learn fear. Fear is a wholesome dread of displeasing God. The first step is the attitude you have toward your money, because the money is the closest thing to your heart. All right, so y'all looking down and funny tonight, but in the judgment, it's going to be your time, abilities, and your resources. All right? Number two, endurance and suffering and hardship for Christ. Everybody that are faithful in their time, abilities, and resources, Revelation 2:20 will show you that they will get a crown of life. Revelation 2:20 will show you a crown of life is waiting for those that are faithful in those particular areas. All right. It says, fear none of these things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that ye may be tried, and ye shall have a tribulation. You shall have tribulation 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. All right. That was in the area of suffering, but the second point I want to make, endurance and suffering and hardship for Christ and the gospel's sake. That's going to be, there will be a crown of life given to those that endure in the area of suffering and hardship for Christ. Okay, James 1:12. The first one was Revelation 2:10. Both of them are dealing with the crown of life. Did I say what? Okay, Revelation 2:10, okay. James 1, what? 12. This is a good one in James. All right, James 1:10, it says, James 1:12, okay. Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, but when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord had promised to them that love him. Okay, so endurance and suffering. All right, now that is the second area, suffering. Y'all know what sufferings are. All right, number three, a crown of rejoicing for our commitment to winning souls. Crown of rejoicing. This is found in 1 Thessalonians 19:20. 1 Thessalonians 19. 1 Thessalonians. Doesn't sound like it must be 19. 1 Thessalonians must be 2. Crown of rejoicing. Yeah, or what is our hope? Our joy, our crown of rejoicing. Or not even ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ at his coming. So that would be a crown that will be given to those that were committed to winning souls. And you might want to write Ezekiel 3:17-21 along with that, because that kind of points out that admonition the Lord told us to those that are drawn unto death, and for us to, if we don't reach out to them and they die in that condition, Scripture says that their blood will be what? It will be what? Okay, it will be what charged to our hands. Okay, that's Ezekiel 3:17. Now, I assume that everybody knows these, but probably we don't. Ezekiel 3. Let's go back there right quick, because this is going to be a big issue at the judgment seat in terms of what did you do about the most important issue that I commanded you to do. Ezekiel, Ecclesiastes, what did I say? Just healing to be down here at night. She's not in her place. Son of man, I have made thee a watchman. This is the responsibility that the Lord has made us. A watchman. Everybody say, I'm a watchman. Unto the house of Israel, therefore hear the word of my mouth. Give them what? Warning from me. That's important. Warning. Sometimes we don't want to confront people. We don't want to tell them that they really need to, you know, get saved. There's a nice way you can tell them, but many times we just don't want to confront people, because sometimes it will cause people to kind of look down on us or frown or avoid us. So sometimes that fear will cause us from actually reaching out to people and telling them the truth. The Bible says, give them what? Warning from me. When I say unto the wicked, thou shalt surely die, thou givest him not warning, nor speakest to warn the wicked from his wicked way to save his life, the same wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood will I require at thine hand. Okay, so that's going to be an issue at the judgment seat of Christ if we make it to that particular judgment. Yet if thou warn the wicked and turn not from his wicked, and he turn not from his wickedness, nor from his wicked way, he shall die in his iniquity. But thou hast delivered thy soul. So that's the good part. You need to tell people, be straight up with them, tell them in a nice way. And that was one of the motivations I had for putting this together, the Lord's compassion. When you share the Lord's compassion to people, people will receive compassion much better than a judgment message. Amen. Right? Amen. So when you share the compassion, you can lead people to Christ very easy through what? Compassion scriptures. The compassion approach is really a good approach. It's much better than warning people about what? If they die, they're going to hell. Amen. So I have focused a whole lot on perfecting God's love. What happened from the cross to the throne? This is basically what you have in this book here. The Lord's Compassion, the Soul Winner's Manual, that's what I'm speaking about now. The Soul Winner's Manual, the part that focuses on God's love, we make about 7 points. And those points are basically what happened from the cross to the throne. If you can share with people what Jesus has done for them, to make it possible for them to be released of their sins and for them to come into right standing with God, most times people will come under conviction much quicker that way than you harping on their sins. Somebody said one ounce of honey, one drop of honey can catch more flies than a whole gallon of vinegar. One drop of honey can catch more flies than a gallon of vinegar. Okay, so those are some areas that we just want you to understand that the wicked need to be warned, and he need to be told that Jesus loves him, and that if he persists in his sins, that he will eventually show him the story of Lazarus and Lazarus and the rich man. But if you warn him, the scripture says, thou hast delivered thy soul. So you will get credit for sharing the gospel with that person. All right, verse 20 again. Let's look at that. When a righteous man doth turn from his righteousness and commit iniquity. So you have a lot of people that start out with the Lord and then they what? Grow weary, turn back, fall out, faint, quit, give up, faint, and die. Those people need to be what? Warned. When a righteous man doth turn from his righteousness and commit what? Iniquity, and I lay a stumbling block before him, he shall what? Die. Because thou hast not given him warning, he shall die in his what? Sin. And his righteousness which he hath done shall not be remembered, but his blood will I require at thine hand. That is amazing. When a person starts out with the Lord and do many wonderful works, and then they turn around and the devil lays a stumbling block, get all ensnared and messed up. And what happens is that that person, if he's not given a warning and somebody won't help him, he's going to what? Die in his sins. And all of the righteous deeds that he did, suppose he lived for the Lord 10 years. The scripture says none of those deeds will be what? Will be remembered. But his blood will I require at what? Thy hand. So the Lord will require his blood at your hand. So we got to be concerned about, sometimes we say, well, everybody's for himself and God for us all. Amen. The church, they know what a church is. They know what time we hold church. They know they can drive. Well, why should I be concerned about them? But that's not what the scripture teaches. Verse 21, nevertheless, if thou warn the righteous man that the righteous sin not, and he doth not sin, he shall what? Surely die, because he is what? Warned. Also thou hast what? Delivered thy soul. So the saints in your midst, they need to be what? Encouraged. They need to be what? Built up. They need to be warned. They need to be prayed for. They need to be what? Amen. They need some attention. And it's us that are to give each other. We are our brother's what? Keeper. All right. So when if I miss coming to know inside, if I don't show up on Sunday, two or three Sundays straight, nobody know anything, if I haven't told Sister Hill anything, some of y'all will get concerned, right? All right. So I get concerned too when people don't show up. But it's up to somebody to what? To connect with people. All right, that's about all I can get in tonight. Our commitment to winning souls. And let me just give you this scripture. You've got to have this scripture. Daniel 3. This applies to soul winning. Daniel 3. Just covet faithfulness. I covet endurance and suffering. I covet our commitment to winning souls. I'm doing the last scripture now in Daniel. And the other, I won't be able to get to, hospitality and kindness shown to the needy and those experiencing hardship for the gospel's sake. And those, the fifth one is those who control their flesh and succeed in overcoming sin, the works of the flesh, Satan, and the world. And the last one would be the faithfulness of pastors and leaders who have oversight over God's people. So all of them will be given unique crowns, crown of glory for faithfulness of pastors and leaders. And for those who control their flesh and succeed in overcoming sin, the works of the flesh, Satan and the world, they will get a crown of righteousness. If you keep your body under, live holy, and overcome the flesh, Satan and the world, you get a crown of righteousness. And hospitality and kindness also gives you a crown of righteousness. All right, but that last scripture in Daniel, because I promised to do that, Daniel 12:3. Okay, I believe it is. And they that be what? Wise. There's a scripture somewhere that says, he that winneth souls is what?
Wise.
And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament. And they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. So those that win souls are going to have like a halo around their head. Right here. This is it. The Bible said they're going to shine. Well, how many want to shine?
Amen.
How many want to shine?
Amen.
All right, make sure you read Ezekiel 3 good. How many want to go around heaven with a halo around your head? Very special crown of rejoicing. How many of you be the happiest thing in heaven? Ooh, Lord Jesus. All right, this kind of will give you the reason why we're studying chapters like we're studying in the profile of a true disciple. Because God wants us to be interested in the things that's going to mean a whole lot to us in the end. Because all of the life that we're living and all of this life's journey is all leading to one thing. At the end, scripture says that it's appointed unto man once to die, and after death, then the judgment. Boy, the judgment is a big issue. It's a big issue. All right. It's a big issue. All right. God bless you. I want you to do lesson 3 and lesson 4, and we're going to touch on Moses, and we're going to begin to focus on the price tag that has to be paid in order for us to be able to enjoy the fullness of the blessings that God has awaited us. The Bible says, eye hasn't seen, neither ear has heard, neither has it entered into the heart of men. The things that God has prepared for them that what? God got some fantastic things planned for us throughout eternity. 1,000 years just to be the beginning. After the 1,000 years, we're going to be recommissioned and we're going to reign with him throughout eternity. Amen. God bless you. That's all we have. Make sure you have your workbook and you have this material, because it's going to get very serious when you get to chapter 4. Very serious. Okay, everybody standing. God bless you. Thank you, folks, for coming. I see some of y'all didn't want to come back Sunday evening. All right. But Sunday evening, it will be at 5 o'clock. And we're asking all members. And I read over in Hebrews that God is going to hold the pastor responsible for people. I mean, they're going to have to what? Obey them that have what? Ruler over them. Because they are what? The pastor's watching over their souls. If I'm watching over you, I better what? I better do my best to get you in line. And we got to get past this what? Lukewarm, this attitude in terms of our worship. But I got something already planned for that after the weather gets a little better. That's something planned for your breakthrough. We got something for your breakthrough.
All right, let's all lift up our hearts. Father, tonight we thank you as we leave this place. We leave knowing that you who hath begun the good work within us is you that's going to perform it until the day of the coming of Jesus. Father, we give you the praise and the glory in Jesus' name. Everybody just say, in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.